na your own, oh baby. 30 billion for the account, yo. Yeah. Versace and Gucci for your body, oh baby. Nadu, gara gara for me. Nadu, said I know. Nadu, shakara, oh, eh. Nadu, gara gara for me. Yeah, yeah, beauty, hutu. My number one in tutu. Sipping bruku tutu. For your love, it tutu.
That was the new song by David O, and it's called If. If you love it, go onto iTunes and download it now. On the first segment of the show, we are talking about friends and envy, and our hot topic of the day is, so now you know about the affair, then what? I have with me Andrea Giaccaglia, who is PR and talent manager extraordinaire. Thanks for coming.
Thank you for having me.
Makashe Awogboro.
Hi.
Co-owner of Olivia's Strum. Thank you for joining me.
Thank you for having
me. And our Nollywood and international actor, Beverly Naya. Hey. Thank you, guys.
You're
so,
welcome.
First segment, let me just start with the quote that I recently heard somebody had quoted after a Q&A at a conference. And she asked the question and said, when you're doing better than your friends and you detect envy as the main issue, how do you handle it? Now, I want to say doing better is relative because, you know, let's just say doing better means you maybe have more money and are seemingly more up or wealthy.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the panelists responded saying, it is your responsibility to carry them along. It is your responsibility to ensure that nothing in you causes envy to rise in one another. So, I stopped for a second and I thought, wait, so is it my responsibility to make sure that, you know, friends don't kind of, you know, envy me?
Yeah.
Not me personally, but, you know, a friend doesn't envy you if you are seemingly
more successful.
And I thought, I don't know if I agree with that statement. So, of course, you guys can, you know, chop it up. I'm going to start with you, Beverly.
Yeah, because you've been looking at me the whole time.
I don't think it's my responsibility at all. I mean, as they say, you can't dim your sparkle to please anyone.
Mm-hmm.
So if I feel like I need to do that to ensure that our friendship is intact, then I don't think it's working. I think it's a toxic friendship, and I'm willing to let that friendship go to be happy.
So in terms of carrying them along,
mm-hmm.
so you're an actress.
Yeah.
I'm sure that you post a girl, you know, your face is on movie posters. Surely there has to be some kind of reaction from your friends.
Really?
Some reaction or no reaction, actually, because no reaction might be a problem. You know what I mean? If it's not congratulations.
Yeah.
Have you had any issues with that? And or do you not sort of look to friends for acknowledgement?
For me personally, like, my closest friends are in London,
mm-hmm.
and I've known each one of them for at least 10 years or more,
mm-hmm.
you know? So, at this point, I don't think so. We're all on different paths. Like, out of all of my close friends, I'm the only one that's actually in entertainment. I'm mm-hmm. the only one that actually lives in Nigeria.
Mm-hmm.
So we're on different paths. So there's nothing really to envy, you know?
Mm-hmm.
The plan is that we all make it. So
right.
For me, I don't think so.
So
but in the industry, mm-hmm. slightly different. Yeah.
What's the difference in the industry?
I mean, I just, sometimes it feels like not everyone is happy for you, you
mm-hmm.
know? Like,
mm-hmm.
I've just learned how to just stay in my lane and
right.
keep my eye on the
mm-hmm.
ball and not have any expectations from anyone out
so
there.
So even industry friends, like, you know, obviously there's competition. So when
yeah.
you get a role that maybe somebody
yeah,
was denied.
It's definitely there.
So how do you handle that?
I just keep it moving, you know? It's not like they don't congratulate you. Most
mm-hmm.
times they do congratulate you, but you kind of sense the
mm-hmm.
should have been me type of thing
mm-hmm.
or why her, like, you sense
mm-hmm.
it sometimes, but you just have to keep it moving. You can't dwell
mm-hmm.
in the negativity.
So do you agree with any part of that statement?
I definitely agree with
mm-hmm.
the majority of what she's saying.
Mm-hmm.
I feel like responsible
mm-hmm.
is such a strong word to use.
Mm-hmm.
You are not responsible for anybody else's happiness.
Mm-hmm.
They are, and you can't control what triggers envy.
Let me try to explain what I think she's saying by responsible.
Uh-huh.
I think that, okay, there are some people where it's obvious that you're successful. Let me now even say Nigerian standards of success. She has married, she has born one baby boy and baby girl, you know? And then her career, she's winning, like a woman that is maybe winning in
all
every
round.
All round.
Mm-hmm.
I think if for instance, maybe your husband was able to afford you a Range Rover, for instance, he's always on Snapchat, he's always on Instagram, Gucci watch, everything laid out. You know, you're doing things that are causing envy or can easily cause envy.
Then that means she has a complex herself. Mm-hmm. So you still
don't think that those things that you're doing, you know, can cause people to be...
I mean, it can definitely cause envy and jealousy, but there's nothing to say that you shouldn't be in the passenger seat of the Range Rover taking the selfie with
you. You're picking me up.
You're my friend, and naturally you want your friends to do what you're doing and be where you are and have the same experiences and be happy. So if I'm taking a selfie, you're going to be in it. And that's just that.
Yeah.
Here's what I want to say, what the person probably meant by responsibility. Mm-hmm. Thinking of it in the African mentality. Mm-hmm. You know how when you're growing and you're becoming successful and you have friends, people automatically assume your friends need to, you also need to put them into the loop and make them also successful as well. Mm-hmm. So maybe what the person meant by saying responsibility is by, if you're making a lot of money, keep your friends in the loop and make money with them. Mm-hmm. But what people fail to understand is that it's not every friend you can work with, because it's not every friend that has the same work ethics. Mm-hmm. Some people are extremely lazy, you know?
Yeah.
Some people just don't know how to execute things. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So it's not everybody that you can carry along
with you.
Exactly. And it's not fair. If somebody's your friend, it's not fair for them to make you feel bad because you're becoming successful. As a friend, you're supposed to support the person regardless of what it is.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And both of you are just supposed to find different ways of working together.
Yeah.
And everybody has what they're good at. Mm-hmm. And it's not everybody that's going to be rich. There are over, what, 6 billion people in the world. Mm-hmm. Like 20% are rich. The rest of it.
Less than
you know?
That. Yeah.
So it's, people just need to understand that everybody's time
is different.
It's different, you know.
So I want to ask, because I was uncomfortable with some of the words, you know, that I heard. Are you okay saying that somebody envies you? Like, are you comfortable if you know that that is what it is? Can you do you feel comfortable saying that she's envious of me?
No.
Why?
No,
why
do you? Because you know, if you think someone is envious of you, most of the time it's an assumption based on the person's attitude.
Mm-hmm.
So to come out and say it when the person hasn't confirmed it, that, I'm actually envious of you, I'm jealous of you.
But how many people are really going to confirm?
So, yeah, but then that's why you don't want to put yourself in a position where you are the one
because
to say that.
Because they'll always deny it anyway.
Exactly. They'll always deny it. So why put yourself in a position where you say, this person's not talking to me anymore because they're jealous.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the most you could probably say to keep it, you know, diplomatic is like, we're not friends anymore because, you know, we just have different interests right now and we're all grown and we kind of grew apart as time went on.
Yeah,
but I don't think it's necessary to say, this person is jealous of me.
Yeah.
Because then it also shows that it reflects on you as well as a bad friend. Mm-hmm. If the person was really your friend, even if the person walks away, you still won't use certain words to describe the person.
Yeah.
Maybe it's just me, but when people are my friends, even when we're not friends anymore, I still will not say certain things about them, regardless of what the situation was. So yeah, I don't think it's right to still use the word envious or jealous.
Are you comfortable saying that she's jealous of me? Do you feel uncomfortable saying that? If you know that that's what it is?
I would probably think it, but I wouldn't say it because it would look bad on me.
Yeah. Why is that? Do you put yourself out
as not being humble?
Yeah,
and that's not a good trait to have.
That's a reflection on
Okay, but how about calling things as though, I mean, I get it because I'm still, I'm not even comfortable saying it, but I'm questioning why that is a discomfort. I don't think that, you know, if somebody stole, you say the person is a thief.
Yes,
you know what I mean?
Yeah.
If the person
But that's
is,
because it's, it doesn't affect your character. It doesn't make you look bad, you know. If
I don't
you
think
say
it makes me, because I'm not the one who's jealous.
Yeah, but if you think someone, I mean, who are you to say that someone is jealous of you?
No, because some people are blatant about it. Some people are envious. Oh, who does she think she is? You know, like, I could just be looking good. Mm-hmm. And it's a case of, who does she think she is? That is jealousy, and that's petty. Mm-hmm. From your angle, why should I feel bad calling out, that's just jealousy, don't be so petty? I don't know why we, you know, humble ourselves.
I would rather, like, give a scenario and then let someone else say it to me.
Yeah.
I'll come back to you, Makashe, and ask about knowing when somebody is in your corner.
Yeah.
Have you ever had to draw that line and cut somebody off and be like, you know what, this particular thing that you did is unforgivable?
Yes. I have. I feel like with friends, you've pretty much aired out what is crossing the line for you, what your opinions are, where you stand on certain things. And if you just feel like somebody's crossing you one too many times, depending on the
situation.
What's
your idea? What's crossing you?
Like just having it's okay to disagree. Mm-hmm. That's normal. Yeah. Human beings are different. But if it's something you feel strongly about and you almost feel like the person has gone out of their way mm-hmm. to overstep their boundaries, mm-hmm. then that's crossing you. Mm-hmm. And there's two ways to handle it. You can just mm-hmm. be upfront and be, you know, nasty and straight about mm-hmm. it. Or you can just ease them out. Like, mm-hmm. it's like, oh, do you want to come over? Oh, I'm occupied. Do you mm-hmm. want to do this? Oh, actually, I have something, something. They'll get the message eventually. You don't have to spell it out to them because most people aren't that, mm-hmm. you know.
Yeah. So is that your that's your breakup style?
Yeah.
So you just literally just ghost.
No, I'm not a ghoster.
Okay.
I'm for sure. You're the other person.
Slowly, yeah.
I may not curse you out, but I'm going to tell you, you know what, this is not working for me. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And then if you don't get the message after that, mm-hmm. then I ease my way.
Yeah. What's your breakup style? Friendship breakup style?
I have three styles. It's either I ghost on you. It depends on what you do. It's either I ghost on you or two, I tell you mm-hmm. how you've offended me. And if nothing improves, uh-huh. then I ghost on you. Uh-huh. Or three, I just ease my way out.
Do you think that particularly with women, that there are sometimes, it's always some dumb shit, though. Like, you know what I'm saying? It's just always some dumb stuff that friendships of like 20 years, 10 years just end up breaking up. Do you think that there's something in us particularly that doesn't want to resolve? I don't know. Female friendships can be a bit messy. You know what I mean? Like,
I think when it's over, it's over. Mm-hmm. So I guess when the petty shit happens, you're like, this friendship was gonna die anyway.
Why aren't we able to comfortably say those petty things that have been bothering us for years?
I can.
Are you comfortable saying it? Are you one of those people that feels the need to address it, or you just let it pile up and it becomes, oh, I'm done?
For me to cut off somebody, it takes a lot.
Okay,
so you would obviously know what you did. Mm. And I'm not gonna tell you what you did.
Oh, okay.
For me,
because I feel like you know what you did.
Yeah.
And if I'm not talking to you, you should know why I'm not talking to you, because you did something that you shouldn't have done. Mm-hmm. And people,
somebody has told me that's not fair, because that's one of my styles as well.
Isn't that passive aggressive?
That's why I started by saying it takes a lot to make me stop talking to somebody or to cut you off. And I just go like, I just cut you off.
Yeah.
I mean, if I see you, I would be civil, but I probably would never call you or hang out with you anymore. So people that are my friends know that you must have done something. And if you're doing something serious, you know exactly what you're doing. You wouldn't have done something petty.
Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, I'm going to let you summarize, Makashe, and let the people know what to look out for when a chick just isn't in your corner.
They never have anything positive to say. Mm-hmm. They're not encouraging. Mm-hmm. They don't support you. Mm-hmm.
Well, if your business is whack, hold up. Just make sure that your business is on point. You know what I mean? Because if I don't like your fabric, I'm not shopping in your shop.
If you don't like my fabric and you're not shopping in my shop, you should call me and be like, I'm not sure about this color scheme. Have you ever thought about maybe introducing... So-and-so, that is you supporting me without directly saying your stuff is whack.
So
that's what I mean by supporting.
Sorry, I'm going to let you carry on with your points, but I've heard a few things. Oh, I had a store opening. Mm-hmm. You know, she didn't buy fabric. Okay, I don't like your fabric.
It's not by force.
You know what I mean? That's what I'm saying. So there are people that really get in their feelings. But let her summarize and we'll come back to you. I'll come back to you. They're not in your corner. They don't support you.
They're always negative.
So it's the energy and the feeling you get when you're around them.
You know, you can come up with a great idea, but at the end of the conversation, the person's like, well, that's not going to work. That's not going to work. That's not work. Instead of saying, I can see that we're going to have some obstacles, but let me come up with a plan because I still think it's doable. That is someone who's not being negative. Mm-hmm. That's someone who's being realistic about the situation, but also encouraging about the situation.
Mm-hmm. So, also, beware of competitive friends. Yes. Mm. That's really toxic.
I think competition is good.
But that's what I'm saying, because sometimes when it's not even in the same field, like I can get... If you're competitive, we're in the same industry and we're gunning for the same thing, but maybe I'm banking, you know what I mean? And I'm in media, somebody else is a caterer, you know what I mean? Exactly. Like, why do you have to be, you know, on that level? Like, everybody's time is different, like you were saying, but you wanted to say something else, right? Didn't you?
Yes, I wanted to say something in relation to the buying of the fabric. So, you know, like in Nigeria, weddings are really big and buying of ashrae bead and things like that. I've actually heard scenarios firsthand where the bride actually stopped talking to her, some of her close friends, because
they didn't buy a shrubby.
And it's not because they didn't want to, but you don't know someone's pocket. Do you know what I mean? And I think that's just terrible.
Yeah, that is terrible.
There are friends that are petty. I think it's just a case of, men, y'all need to get out your feelings, because first of all, and then the ashrabi is not cheap these days.
It's increasing by the day.
Like, I'm like, I'm not gonna wear this dish again. Like,
I'm telling you.
So people need to just, I think the trend even needs to
And I feel like friends like that.
Yeah, friends like that.
Yeah, they're not friends.
But I mean, I guess you kind of feel like when it was their turn, some people feel like when it was their turn, I bought your own.
Yeah,
so
you
why can't you buy my own?
Yeah, exactly.
And then you probably know my situation, that I don't have as much money as you do.
Yeah.
So you can't make me feel bad because I'm not, you know, as privileged.
Sleeping with someone to buy
a
shirt for your wedding.
Well, I guess it's safe to say that we all don't agree with the fact that it's your responsibility to carry any friend along, or make sure that there's nothing inside you that is causing them to envy. We don't buy it. You shouldn't be, what's the word, covetous. You shouldn't covet what your neighbor has. You know what I mean? Just be yourself and be okay in being you. And
be
know
content.
That your time is coming. It's not every day, you know, every day is for the thief, one day is for the owner. You know what I mean? You'll get there.
Yeah.
Well, that's it for this first segment, guys. After the break, we'll be delving into the hot topic of the day.
Hi, guys. Here's the story. I got married to my husband Deji 3 years ago. At first, there was a bit of drama initially because of who his ex-girlfriend Aisha is. Let me explain. Aisha is a family friend of mine that has been in my life since I was 4. Her mom and my mom are best friends, her dad's business partners with my dad, and both our families are very intertwined. I like Aisha. We get on very well, but I've always felt Aisha was more of a cousin than a friend. Our lasting relationship is largely due to the external forces around us. Our families come together on weekends, birthdays, and Christmas holidays, and they frequently travel together. It's a deep relationship and it's been that way for donkey years. Recently, her family have been very supportive since my mother was diagnosed with stage 4 cancer. She's down to stage 2 and the treatments abroad are very expensive. Aisha's parents committed financially to her hospital bills and have been doing so for nearly 6 months. Aisha and Deji dated for 2 years after she graduated university. She was 23 and I knew nothing of their relationship. Fast forward 9 years later, I met and married Deji at 32. There was talk about how wrong and awkward it was when I announced he was my boyfriend. My aunties and pastors urged us to break up and told me to find someone new. But Deji and I were a year in the relationship by then and our love was strong. We were both good friends and wanted to be together. I felt a bit of guilt, to be honest, because I did care about Aisha's feelings even though we weren't the closest. So, to put an end to all the chatter and scrutiny around my relationship, I decided to have a sit-down with Aisha, and she was surprisingly gracious about the situation. She said she didn't understand what the fuss was about and she was happy that I found love, and that Deji was her past. He was a good person, but not for her. She went further to emphasize that they ended things quite amicably and she found a friend in him over time. She was a bridesmaid at my wedding and things have never been awkward. I struggled with infertility for 3 years. But in those 3 years, I focused on my interior design company and it helped me take my mind off things. That devotion paid off and business has been booming for me lately. I was recently doing a recce for a guest house that needed partial renovations and the owner was showing me around the site. We had just agreed on a concept for a breakfast lounge and as we approached the hallway to inspect some rooms, what I saw next shocked me. We walked into Deji and Aisha giving each other a goodbye kiss and holding hands outside what looks to me like a room he had rented. I was with the owner of the guest house and the other corporate clients, so I was forced to be professional. I acknowledged both of them with a smile, but I noticed a look of triumph in her face as she walked away, and it was immediately apparent that me dating him in the first place never sat well with her. I offended her more than I ever knew. 2 weeks ago, I found out I was 2 months pregnant, and I haven't told anyone. I was waiting till I passed the 3-month safe zone. This whole situation has placed me in a state of disequilibrium, and I need to find some peace. What is the right thing to do given our family dynamics and current financial support from her family? I haven't said a word in my home for over 3 weeks and neither has he. Is me not saying anything signaling some sort of passivity or acquiescence? What do you do once you've learned your spouse has been unfaithful? Mostly, people imply that infidelity demands an immediate response or action. Taking action seems better, but is it always productive? I still love him, but should this be a deal breaker?
Welcome back, guys. And now it's time for our topic. So you know about the affair. Now what? I'm going to pass it on to my first guest to let us know what she thinks about this nightmare of a Deji guy.
Oh, my goodness. I don't even know what to say. Wow.
So let me start with asking, would you have been able to maintain professionalism in that, you know, scenario where you're with your clients, obviously you see something that you know is a compromising situation? Because some people ask me, how do you know what they did? I think it's clearly obvious when you see your husband coming out of a room kissing and holding hands with Aisha, you know, not really her best friend, because she sees her more like a cousin. She's a family friend. She's a close person. Do you think that that was the right thing to do? Or do you think that people aren't always going to be so predictable?
I think people are not always going to be that predictable. And I think it takes a very strong person to hold themselves back and, you know, keep yourself together. So definitely it was a very tight situation. Mm-hmm. But I think she acted right,
right,
if you ask me. I think that was the right thing to do. However, mm-hmm. I don't think, why is the guy quiet for 3 weeks?
Mm-hmm. He hasn't said anything.
Exactly.
Because I guess he's waiting for, you're already guilty. So yeah, he's waiting for her to say something.
Yeah, but what are you waiting for her to say?
Because mm-hmm. he's like, he doesn't want to say anything, and he could be wrong, you know? So he's just going to keep quiet until something is said.
Yeah, mm-hmm. but then if you know...
Could be. Girl, exactly. He is all the way wrong.
Mm-mm. No. Like, in the sense that he doesn't know what she knows, right?
Mm-hmm.
No, he saw her.
Oh, they all saw each other. It was clear what happened.
Oh, then he smiled at them and said hello and walked away with her clients. Oh. So she knows, he knows exactly she saw her.
He doesn't value her.
Though. Exactly. Mm-hmm. He obviously doesn't respect her.
Yeah.
He has no value for her. He's definitely not sorry for what he did.
Yeah.
Because how do you do something like that to your wife and keep quiet for 3 weeks?
And she's kept quiet for 3 weeks? Yeah.
Well, she probably doesn't know what to say. But I want to actually ask, let me ask you, Makashe.
Mm-hmm.
What do you do when you find out? Do you have like an idea in your head?
What I would do personally,
yeah.
I think I'm a bit unpredictable in this situation because everybody has a deal breaker for mm-hmm. them in their relationship. Mm-hmm. I feel like at this stage in my life, I don't know how well I'd react to finding out my husband was cheating on me. Mm-hmm. So I can't say I would explode. I can't say that mm-hmm. I would just keep quiet. I really mm-hmm. don't know.
Mm-hmm.
God forbid I'm ever in that situation. Mm-hmm. But for me, definitely keeping her cool in public was good. You know, because you're not bringing more attention to the situation. And then when I'm at home for 3 weeks, if he hasn't said anything and I haven't said anything,
mm-hmm.
I would hope that she's using her time wisely to think of her next move.
Right. Yeah.
Being like, if I'm going to stay in this relationship, am I going to have a chat with him and be like, this is where I stand.
Mm-hmm.
If I catch you again, X, Y, and Z is going to happen. Or if mm-hmm. this is the way you see this moving forward, please respect me a little bit and try and do it mm-hmm. out of dodge mm-hmm. so that I don't know about it kind mm-hmm. of thing. Because there are some people who are okay with that at the end of the day.
Mm-hmm.
Different people get married for different reasons.
Mm-hmm.
Most people get married for love. Some people get married for money. Mm-hmm. Some people get married for whatever reason. Mm-hmm. If you're the type of person that knows that you can deal with a cheating husband because you have school fees that need to be paid and you want to go to mm-hmm. London on summer holiday, then the chances of you exploding and being mm-hmm. all of in his face
mm-hmm.
are slim to none.
Mm-hmm.
But if you know you married for love and that if you left,
mm-hmm.
you could do just as well and mm-hmm. you could support yourself emotionally, mm-hmm. financially,
mm-hmm.
physically, then, you know, it's just something you need to think about.
But do you think the grass is greener?
No, the grass is not always,
you know, there's
the
whole
side.
Okay, you leave, right? Mm-hmm. In this situation, she's pregnant,
right?
So that changes the entire dynamic of the entire situation because she hasn't said anything, and I guess her silence could signal, you know, I'm about to have a baby.
Mm-hmm.
It's a positive experience. I can't imagine, you know,
mm-hmm.
how that feels.
Yeah.
You have joy on the inside of you that's growing, and then you witness this.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, the decision to leave isn't as easy.
No,
you know,
no,
when a child is involved or a child is on the way.
Yes, especially for someone that's tried so hard to have a child.
Yeah, uh-huh.
I think that it's definitely worth trying
uh-huh.
one more time.
Uh-huh.
I think at this point you need to speak up and say something uh-huh. and be like, hey, we're having a big... For all you know, that could have been one of the factors that made him just behave
uh-huh.
out of his character.
Uh-huh.
Now that you're having a baby, you'd be surprised he's... Come, he's reined himself back in and he's ready to do it the right way. You know what I mean? So
you believe in a second chance then? Somewhat.
Yeah, somewhat. I believe in a second chance. Yeah.
Well, Beverly, you've played quite a number of roles. Let me speak to your character at the wedding party.
Yeah.
You were a little tarty. You tried to rhyme a little bit. The character was, you know, obviously the Aisha in this situation.
Yeah.
Do you think Aisha has an agenda? Do you think it is what it is? Because obviously... It's obvious that she has always kind of wanted to, you know, get Deji's wife back, mm-hmm. you know, for dating him in the first place. It's mm-hmm. obvious that when you said you were cool about it in the first place, you weren't really cool. So do you think that there's more to it? Do you think it's going to end there? Or do you think that with, given the dynamics of the situation, that Aisha is parking?
It would definitely carry on.
Okay, I think so you don't think it's over?
No, not at all. So Aisha saw the wife as well.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Yeah, of course not. She doesn't mm-hmm. respect her either.
Yeah.
You know, she's like, if I can, I mean, I can have him if I want to. That's basically mm-hmm. what that means, mm-hmm. you know. So that's not going to end anytime soon.
So would you suggest that she left the relationship or she considered leaving?
For me,
this is a three-year marriage.
And to go 3 weeks without speaking to each other, and mm-hmm. he feels like that's okay, and he doesn't owe her an apology. Mm-hmm. And for her to feel the need to actually speak to him first to mm-hmm. save their marriage, mm-hmm. there's a huge issue yes. there. Mm-hmm.
But then that silence, doesn't that silence even speak louder? Because it sounds to me like that's what you guys are saying, that the fact that he hasn't even said anything after the 3 weeks is even more of a message. It's a louder message.
Care.
Exactly.
He doesn't care.
You know, oh, wow. Oh, wow.
Doesn't care.
So, because, you know, girl, there's a silence where mm-hmm. he's being apologetic mm-hmm. and you, the woman, are fronting and you're not talking to him.
Exactly.
And he's still being apologetic mm-hmm. for 3 weeks and the woman is not talking.
Mm-hmm.
But if the guy is not trying to make any effort to even address the situation because you are in the wrong,
mm-hmm.
you know, then he obviously doesn't care.
Doesn't
care. And for me, I think with somebody like that,
mm-hmm.
even if there's a baby in the situation, it's not going to change.
It's not going to change.
Because if you, I believe that if you really like somebody, and I don't even want to use the word love because maybe it would probably be too strong of a word,
mm-hmm.
but even if you like somebody in the tiniest remote, you know, way possible,
mm-hmm.
and you do something like this to hurt someone that you like,
mm-hmm.
you would show some kind of remorse.
Remorse,
for it,
you know, simple,
you don't have to wait for there to be a baby that will come along, or wait for a reason for you to mm-hmm. come back. And even if you mm-hmm. don't want to be married to her anymore, you still need to apologize because at that point in time, you were disrespectful.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So you can even go back and be like, you know what, we've tried, it's not working, I've tried, mm-hmm. I thought I loved you, but mm-hmm. I really, you know, I have respect for you and all of this, but I can't do this marriage anymore. But don't be quiet for 3 weeks.
But there are relationships like that where a guy is unapologetic. So let's even take it out of this particular situation. Mm-hmm. And a guy is completely unapologetic. This is not the last time. I'm going to tell you that this is not the last time. He can even apologize. Well, guess what?
He's
going to do it again.
Yeah.
So that's my thing. So do you have to address infidelity every time it happens? Or do you feel that there is an element of let some things pass if you are not ready to leave?
Yeah.
Okay.
I think
do I say that?
You need to let some things pass unless you're ready to leave.
Unless you're ready to leave.
If not, there's no point in getting yourself all
depends
worked
on why
up
she's in the relationship.
And causing a big fuss.
It depends on why.
If you're still going to be there tomorrow morning and
then,
ask him what he wants for breakfast.
But I feel like, I mean, if she... I feel like this is not the first time. Based on how she reacted to the situation, I feel like she's probably used to this
mm-hmm.
to a certain degree. And I think part of me feels like she probably decided to get pregnant to try to save her marriage.
Mm.
You know, like, because some women do that as well.
Mm.
Yeah.
Okay. Because I even heard auntie say that thing of, they say to you about it, be more, you know, go out, you know, hurry up and, you know, have a child to kind of lock the situation down. Find out what our chicks in the streets had to say.
If I should confront him, you know, men and their lies, he wants to tell me, I swear nothing, or she's trying to come back to me or something. After everything, and I warn him, I don't want to see you with this girl. And I'll call my own cousin personally. I'll ask her some few questions. Her response to that question will determine if she's really the one persuading my husband or she's really wanting something from him. And I'll warn her. I will tell her, I will prove it to her that my husband have made me know that she's the one coming after him. If she doesn't, I'll just kind of put a threat to her. After warning her, I will not want to stress so further because I've given her the first warning. It is when the thing starts, it continues. I will report to my mom first. Then I will beg because she's my cousin. I might go and tell her own parents that look at what is happening. No. Then the way they will respond or the way they will tackle the issue, because first and foremost, we must respect the family first. The way they will tackle the issue, if I see that there is no action in it, then I cannot carry my own.
Cornelia told me, would I think about an exit strategy or would I stay? I'm like, exit strategy to where? I'm 12 years into the relationship already. I'm pregnant. I would fight for my property. I mean, I will hold it down. I'll be like, bitch, where, for where? I'm dramatic, and I wouldn't necessarily, you know, beat her down and all that. But I would just be mature about it and I'll tell her to back off. I wouldn't have to, it should not be an issue where I have to call our parents to have a sit down and trash the issue out. But I'm not going anywhere. I'll fight for my property. If you have a look of triumph, then you're not triumphing anywhere, my dear. You're gonna, my dear, for all the ladies out there going through issues like this, my advice to you is to have a sit down with your husband at home. Have a long conversation, Let him know what's at stake. You can threaten him that you're leaving. Of course, you're not going to leave. But you can threaten him that, you know, you have a home here. Why would you want to try and ruin that? You know? And that Ogbanje girl, what? I will fight her. Whoa. Hey, I don't have to speak Yoruba, but I wish I did right now. So I can say something very rude.
In America, for example, yeah? There are laws protecting women.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
If you're going to cheat in your marriage,
mm-hmm.
what do we, yeah. I mean, prenups and everything.
Prenups, yeah.
Like, uh-huh. There are laws protecting women. Mm-hmm. So, like, cheating isn't as, I mean, it's not as bad as it is in Nigeria. Do you understand? So, it's not like it's impossible.
Mm-hmm.
Do you understand? But because it's kind of like the norm
acceptable.
Over here is acceptable, mm-hmm. is whatever. Like, I just feel like that's the excuse that's given.
Mm-hmm.
I don't believe, like, I feel like if a man chooses not to cheat, he won't cheat.
Mm-hmm.
But if he feels like it's tolerated in his marriage or in his relationship, mm-hmm. he will.
Yeah, mm-hmm. And I think...
It depends on how you present yourself.
Yeah, I also think people should kind of tone it down a bit with the it's greener on the other side phrase.
Mm-hmm.
Because for grass to be green, it has to be watered.
Mm-hmm.
And if somebody's not watering that plant, mm-hmm. it's not going to be green.
Yeah.
So for it to be green on the other side, you need to be on that side, taking mm-hmm. care of the grass and mm-hmm. watering it and keeping mm-hmm. it really neat and clean.
Mm-hmm.
So this green on the other side phrase that people use, I think it's putting people's... It's made people think, you know, I can always find somebody else who
mm-hmm.
would probably be better.
Mm-hmm.
So there's nothing like better.
Yeah.
There's nothing like freer. There's always somebody
that's
going to
be
better than you
mm-hmm.
on something
mm-hmm.
else. There's always somebody that's going to lack in certain
areas.
So it's to find that grounds where, you know, I trust this person. We're actually
mm-hmm.
really good friends. We get along very well.
Mm-hmm.
Because honestly, I think 5, 6, 7 years down the marriage, that love phase of honeymoon period
mm-hmm.
is not going to be there.
Yeah,
yeah,
of course, what
are
you going to fall back on?
Mm-hmm.
Exactly.
The fact that you guys were friends. The fact
mm-hmm.
that you actually trust each other.
Exactly.
The fact that you know that, you know, your husband, he's got your back.
Well, that
loyalty.
Trust is broken, honey. And if you
loyalty.
Don't take care of putting that, because when you say the fact that you trust, I know you're saying this to, you know, maybe advocate more for why you should stay as opposed to thinking it's greener. But I think that men don't realize how much paranoia that they themselves have put in the relationship.
I'm not actually saying that
mm-hmm.
they should stay. But what
mm-hmm.
I'm trying to say is the reason why people are, like how he just acted very nonchalant
mm-hmm.
about it, he was probably thinking in that 3 weeks that if she divorces me, I'll just marry this girl who's
mm-hmm.
my love.
Mm-hmm.
But you don't know what's
yeah.
going to happen once you marry
yeah.
her.
That Aisha situation already for me, I think that's unending paranoia because she's around. She's somebody where the family, I will see her mother and I'm thinking of her.
Yeah.
I will see her father
yeah.
who's my father's business partner and I'm thinking
of
her. She is not going away.
Yeah.
So my thing with this situation is, now she's going away because you can definitely get rid of her. You can find a way to sort of, yeah. You can find a way to definitely block her out of your life. But her parents are paying for
your mom's
cancer treatment. And I do think that both families are well off, but cancer treatment and, you know, treatments
course.
Are quite expensive.
Yeah.
So you can imagine that any financial support is required. That could be why she's quiet
of
for
course.
3 weeks.
Yeah.
Okay, so
because she's gauging it of, my mom has cancer, first of all.
Yeah.
This triangle, if anything, must remain between us
three mm-hmm.
if I'm going to even say anything, because when you start bringing external... So what happens if they stop paying for the hospital bills? That's now the reason why your mother had to be removed from this hospital, blah, blah, blah. And
once
it leads to, you know what I mean? It gets a bit
cancer,
messy.
You move
on. You know what I mean? So, you know, like, and I think that's just to say that sometimes there are other dynamics beyond you
yeah,
in a marriage
yes.
that kind of make it difficult
yeah,
to,
yeah.
you know, to give a black and white response.
And
if you can't forgive,
yes.
right, and you choose to leave,
mm-hmm.
what... advice would you give to a woman who is fresh at, like, who wants to leave? You know, what docs do you think she should have in a row? And can you speak to what you think life would be after?
I think life would totally be, I don't think it would be bad. Mm-hmm. I don't think it would be awesome. Nobody wants mm-hmm. to get married to get divorced. Yeah. But I definitely feel like if you were going to leave, you need to have some sort of family support. Mm-hmm. You need to have some sort of financial support. Mm-hmm. And you need to have a game plan. You mm-hmm. can't just walk out of a marriage being like, right, now I'm done mm-hmm. with that. Let me start thinking of what's next. No, mm-hmm. where are you going to live? Mm-hmm. How are you going to eat? Do you have a job? Do you have kids that have school fees mm-hmm. that need to be paid? Mm-hmm. Does your family support you? Are mm-hmm. they willing to even like mm-hmm. accept you back into the family now that you've been divorced? Because there's many families who are like, no, once you're married, you're married. Don't return back to sender. Like, you know, that type of thing. Yeah. So all that stuff needs to be in order. And then also you need to be justified in leaving. Mm. You can't just say, I left because he wasn't nice to me. Loosely, mm-hmm. he wasn't nice to me. Mm-hmm. There needs to be something of substance that has yeah. occurred mm-hmm. to make you want to leave.
Okay, well, yeah. I guess that's what we're trying to say in the end. Yeah. Have your own money. And if you're going to forgive, forgive honestly, like don't half forgive.
Yeah, exactly.
Let the man and, feel peace. Yeah. Let him enter the house and you can cut the tension with it with a knife in the house. I don't think that's the best way to go, but you've heard it from my studio guests. I'd like to thank you guys for staying with us, and I'll see you next week on Chick Chat Live. If you'd like to subscribe to the tribe, follow us on our social media handles scrolling on the screen.